guys for joining in on this live. It is something that I'm very passionate about, especially with things that's going on in our community. And for those of you who do not know what Give Black to It is, for me, it's more of a state of mind. This platform gives everyone a voice to express what we have going on in our community, specifically Columbus, Ohio. So that's why I started this whole Food for Thought Sundays. Today's topic we're going to be going over is how do we save our voice and empower our Black men. First off, thank you for the people who hit the inbox and addressed some of your concerns. I was able to kind of take notes, write everything down so that we have something to discuss. All right, so first thing that came up that I was having a conversation with my son, which he's here now, and I think that is a good thing for him to be a part of this, especially since he is a young Black male. He is 14 years old. So we were having a discussion, what was it, a couple days ago?
Yesterday.
We were asking questions of, you know, what is your definition of a man? And I think that a lot of us have multiple definitions. I'm going to allow my son to tell you guys, and me, because I didn't let him answer the question yesterday because I wanted to save it specifically for this live, what his definition of a man is.
In my opinion, in the definition of a man would be technically someone who, someone able to carry themselves or in a very respectful manner, or someone who knows that they don't need another human being to function properly, or like knowing your self-worth.
Okay. Anything else you want to add to that?
Mm-hmm.
No? Okay. I would say that my definition of a man is someone who is a provider, someone who takes care of his family, whether he is with his child's mother or not. Someone who gets up and go to work every day. I know that I come from a two-parent household, so I was raised in a situation where my dad works every day. He still works to this day. In fact, my personal opinion would be for him to retire, but I don't see that happening anytime soon. Definitely loving, provides that security there, is always there when you need them. Some people that, you know, was not brought up in a two-parent home. I speak for this for my son because I'm a single mom. However, me and my child's father have a wonderful relationship. We co-parent very well. I definitely could not do it without him. And I'm fortunate that my son has multiple male role models that are positive that are around him. From my brothers to his grandparents to his dad. Just a lot of positive male role models around him. So, another single mom hit me up in my inbox and pretty much was addressing some of her fears. And I know that there are a lot of us that are out there that are raising these boys by ourselves without any type of assistance. And she wanted to address some of her fears as being a Black mom, having a Black son. And I let her know that I would tell her what my thoughts were on that. So, my biggest fear of having a son is him being draped off into the streets, number one. the police, just in general, all around what we go through with those stereotypes, just as a whole. That is my biggest fear. So a lot of us may make the mistake of having that fear to coddle our sons, meaning that you don't want to allow them to
live at all.
And we're all guilty of that. I know I am with my son because I'm very overprotective of him because he is my only child. And sometimes we kind of butt heads on that because I know that with him being 14 and he is finding himself and there's no way for me to keep him out of the streets at all, period. And I don't mean that in a negative light. I mean just going out into the world and just living his life. But I get a lot of flack about that from, you know, his dad and other males in my family saying, hey, you just need to let him do him. You raised him right. So, you know, everything will be good. Going back to my point, a lot of times when we have that fear as a single mom, not only do we coddle our sons, we stop them from being able to deal with emotions. That goes back to, and I don't know if you guys were able to watch the video that I posted to the Get Black To It page, the conspiracy to destroy black boys. It was a lot of good points made in that video. Even though that video came out in 1987, which is over 30 years ago, a lot of those things still apply. And he made a good point when he said that as black women, we tend to raise our daughters and love our sons. And that reverts back to what I was saying about the coddling. Usually, because we do that, we end up stopping our boys from getting out into the world, learning those major skills they should be learning. Another thing that we teach our boys is not to cry. You know, you can't be a punk, you know, to show any type of emotion. Again,
seen as weak, and that could be like a main cause of male depression nowadays, because we can't really have, we don't have any outlet to share our emotions to.
Right.
To share emotions to.
Exactly. So with us doing that, that stops them from being able to deal with not only anger, depression, frustration, fear. They have no way of coping with these emotions because at a young age, we are telling them to, hey, you can't cry. You know, you got to be a man. And that's a mistake that I made early on with my son that I had to try to correct. Because usually when you're a single mom and there's no male that's present, we tend to put our sons in a position of being the man of the house at an early age. From the time they are able to talk and walk, it's like, oh, look at this little man. And, you know, he's the man of the house. And at that point, they're not even equipped to do that. We're not allowing them to be kids. And then it causes a problem when, as a mom, you finally do start to, you know, settle down with someone, or you start to date and you bring a man around, and your son and this new man are butting heads, because in his mind he is the man of the house.
Unless he's able to take the man of the house spot properly, and he knows how to provide and protect you, then I will have no problem with
it. It's by nature. Right. So at the end of the day, you are a boy, you know what I mean, and you're coming into manhood, so you're going to naturally be a protector. As moms, we are responsible for teaching our children their morals, their values, especially if there's no male role model in the house. They learn their morals and values between the ages of about 3 or 4 to 8. So typically, whatever they've learned during that time frame is pretty much stuck in them for the rest of their lives. As men, you lead by example. So whatever example that they have. So I'll give you a perfect example to that. So let's just say, for instance, you have a boy that doesn't have any male role models at all. All he has is his mom, if he has siblings or whatever the case may be. The only thing he's going to be able to see as far as a male role model is what's outside his door or what's on TV or social media. That sound about right?
Yeah, sure. And with it only be female role models in the house, then he most likely pick up more feminine traits, and that would just overthrow the energies in the child itself. Because the energies in a male and masculine are supposed to be balanced, but it can be overthrown if the child is a boy.
Okay. So the only example they have is what's outside the door. So usually, especially depending on what type of neighborhood that you're living in, you know, you have what they call, quote unquote, big homie. That you kind of look up to. However, these may be, you know, men or older boys that are, you know, in the streets, they selling drugs, they in gangs, whatever the case may be. But this is, the wrong big homies. So this is the example that you have, and it doesn't help much at all, because you also have whatever they see on social media, whatever they see on TV. You know, a lot of these rappers don't talk about nothing. They're not talking about anything positive. Now, granted, I'm not going to bash any of the rappers, because I do like some of the music as far as beats go. But it's not necessarily all the way positive for our boys. All right. So that was a good question. So Marquise says, now if the outside world is now holding the right example, then what? Okay. What does the mother do? All right. Well, here's the thing. Again, that goes back to one of the fears is being a mom. There's so many different pedophiles out there. And I know that I don't trust anybody, especially around my son. So as a mom, I would suggest if I was in that situation, I probably would try to find the most positive thing that I could. Because at the end of the day, even though we can raise our boys, we still cannot teach them to be men. So you pretty much do the best that you can. If our examples for men are not being exemplified in society and all we have is homosexuality, what then is the mother to do? Well, I mean, at that point, what can you do? What can you do? The only thing you can go by is whatever the example that you have, especially if you are a mom raising a boy by yourself. But I mean, like I said, you do the best that you can. Onyx, you want to chime in on that?
Mm-hmm.
You don't have nothing to say towards that?
No.
Okay.
Because it all, yeah. It depends. For real, because for real, if it is mainly homosexuality out, then it just matters about when you let your child out. Because you can condition your child and then teach them that that would be wrong. And then they would have a bias towards it.
So going, I'm going to jump back here because I know I'm kind of jumping all around trying to answer questions and just make sure I hit certain points. So another thing that I wanted to kind of go back to as, you know, being a mom and trying to raise your son, going back to the whole coddling thing and the fear and the overprotectiveness, a lot of times what ends up happening is when we are overprotective of our boys and kind of let them, you know, slide on a lot of things just because it's the reason being is, oh, he's just being a boy. They end up going out into the world ill-equipped. They don't know how to handle confrontation. They end up not knowing how to have certain communication skills and life skills. So I feel like it's very important to kind of be versatile and teach our boys certain skills, how to take care of themselves, how to, you know, bathe themselves, how to, you know, groom themselves, cook, clean, because you don't know what situation they're going to be in once they leave your house. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for the best thing that you could possibly do as a mother is just teach them how to take care of themselves when they do leave, just in case if they don't have a significant other that can do the female things that are supposed to be done in the house, like cooking and cleaning and stuff like that. Everything else would just have to be done by a male role model.
Exactly. So just those basic life skills is definitely necessary, because who knows what type of women these other women are raising out here. And I definitely fear for my son, because he is in a situation where he has an example of a woman who cooks, who cleans, and, you know, kind of allows him to do some of those things, but for the most part I'm doing it for him. And that's troubling, because when he gets out in this world and he ends up, you know, getting into a relationship or anything like that, and whoever he is with, if they haven't been raised to have those skills and he doesn't know how to do it himself, then what is he going to do, starve?
I'll be coming back home.
You'll be coming back. Exactly. Coming back home. And the whole goal for us is to raise our kids so they don't have to come back home, where they can make it on their own. One thing that was brought to my attention was, with all of this and trying to, you know, get our boys on track, how do we support our black men more? How do we empower them? Because I get so frustrated with seeing, especially on Facebook and just on TV, social media, period, of the bashing. The bashing of our black men. I'm tired of hearing our women say, excuse me, niggas ain't shit. I'm tired of hearing that. Granted, I'm not going to sit up here and say that, you know, all of them are great, because I've had my own personal relationships that just didn't work out at all, period. And I felt like at the time that they wasn't shit. However, I had to rethink it. And this is not me making an excuse for any of those men out there who are not doing what they're supposed to do or are disrespecting, you know, us women. I had to come to the realization that I didn't take the time to learn that person's history. And a lot of times we make the mistake, we get involved in relationships and don't know what their backstory is, because we're only taking it for face value. And we are only going by what that representative is. And a representative will get you messed up. rushing into things will get you messed up. What I want to stress to all of my black men, especially the ones that are watching, is you still got somebody out there that is rocking with you, that supports you. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care, you know, if you done been to prison, if you down on your luck, whatever the case may be, just know that Miss Karma is rocking with you. And I love all of you. At any time, if you just need some type of advice or some type of pep talk, hit my inbox. Please hit my inbox. I will definitely be there to support as much as I can, because we need you. Sorry, guys. I get a little bit emotional talking about this topic. Going back to what I said about the history, our men deal with so much on a consistent basis. And I don't know what it's like to be a black man. I can only go by the men that I have around me. And I was raised by predominantly mostly men, from my brothers to my uncles to, you know, my dad to my grandfather. I can only know what I've seen. And it's hard enough just being a black man out here, and for them, especially the ones that are trying, that are out here really working and taking care of their families, doing what they're supposed to do, and then they have to come home to, you know, us nagging or not being that support system that's needed. And I know it's hard for us women, because given the shortage of men out here, because a lot of them are in prison, a lot of them are being killed on a consistent basis, we tend to have to do everything on our own, by ourselves. We have to play the mom, the father, the provider, the security, everything all at one time. And that causes a rift, because when you finally, you know, run into that man that is actually trying to lead you, you push them away. And I don't want to get off on topic into the women, because that's going to be next week. I'm going to be, you know, discussing our women and our girls, because I think there's a lot of concerns there that I may have. But one thing I will say for all of those women who keep saying niggas ain't shit, I have all those things to say, remember, you chose that man when it comes to a relationship. You made the choice to be with that person. You've seen the signs ahead of time. Same thing when it comes to our sons. The negativity that I hear some moms say, you know, about their boys is just unbelievable to me. But they keep in mind, you raised that boy. So from now on, for those of you who think that way, change up the sentence. Try saying it more so.
Try saying your taste is.
You said your taste?
Yeah.
Your taste.
Because when you say, the excuse my language, niggas as a whole, generalizing the whole, all of them, then that's going to put down the ones that are actually good, and they wouldn't really want to come to you if they think that they're worthless. Because so far in society, man is only worth as much as they can provide. And if you say that he ain't really nothing, then why would he want to provide for you or stay with you?
Exactly. Amen. So if we are constantly bashing our men, think about the psychological damage that's doing, especially with the ones that are actually out here trying. Do you get what I'm saying? Eventually, they'll start to believe what you're saying. And women don't understand how much power that they have. Whatever we say about our men, the rest of the world is going to believe. So if we out here running around talking about, you know, niggas ain't shit and he did this and he did that, then of course this is what they're going to believe.
Exactly. The same thing goes for vice versa, for males talking down about black women as well. That's why they would have to respect each other first for things to go back to kind of normal.
Exactly. So it all goes back to, would you say respect?
Yeah.
Respect. I'm not talking about the ones who, you know, we can't save at all, period. If you come across someone like that and you know, you see the red flags, I should say, ahead of time, don't even set yourself up for failure that way. But the ones that are out here that are really trying, try to start with them. The only way that we are going to be able to make any difference and to empower our men and to turn our boys into men is if we start with the people that are closest to us. And what I mean by that, our sons, our brothers, our fathers, you start with them, because we can't go out here and help everybody at all, period. But if we can take the time to focus more on our boys and not only, instead of loving them, actually raising them to be men, then you'll start to see that'll branch out. And then pretty soon, which I hope that all of us can get on the same page, or quote unquote, you know, on code, lead by example, not even just for our men, but our women as mothers, lead by example. We are supposed to, let me go back, with our boys, we are the first thing that they see as far as how a woman is supposed to be. That is very important, because that goes into who are they going to look for when they become of age to start dating or whatever the case may be. Same thing, vice versa, with men. Their example, that's who they're going to aspire to be. So we have to be careful what we put our kids, especially our boys, around. I'm trying to keep it to the boys and the men. I'm sorry, I keep going all off about women. Next question I should ask you guys. How do we correct this? How do we correct and ensure that we are supporting our men, we are empowering our men, we are teaching our boys the right path? A couple people that hit my inbox up said that we should start with our boys, because some of the men are, you know, well and grown now, and usually when you get to a certain age, you are who you are. That doesn't mean that they don't deserve support. It just means that those morals and values are within them, and
some of them become ignorant and don't want to change or try and better themselves.
Exactly. I would say, as far as with our boys go, don't make them grow up too fast. Allow them to be kids, because we tend to put a lot of responsibility on our boys, especially when, you know, as a single mom, it's a lot of responsibility there. And I know, like I said, I have been guilty of a number of different things with my son, but I try to kind of correct it early and instill in him certain morals and values and, you know, what my definition is of a man and what you're supposed to do, how you carry yourself, how you interact with people, how you communicate. Another thing that we kind of don't do as parents, even with fathers and mothers, we don't listen to our kids. I know that I can't be the only one being a kid, being young, and wanting to show, you know, my mom or my dad something at one point in time, like, hey, look at this. And they say, you know, hold on, go out of here, I'm doing something, or whatever the case may be. Not saying that it happened to me often, but I know that I'm not the only one that's experienced that. A lot of times, if we stop and listen, we'll learn a lot more, especially with kids. Some people fail to realize that, you know, when you're dealing with kids, they are people too, and they deserve respect just as much as you deserve respect. Case in point, I've hardly ever had to put my hands on my son. I can probably count on one hand how many times he's had a whooping. And those whoopings were because it was a situation where he was about to hurt himself. Now, I'm not sitting up here saying that you ain't supposed to whoop your kids. That's none of my business what you do with yours. I'm just saying that I've never had to really do that, just because it's always been a respect level there. And my son has never seen me be in a light where he felt like he could disrespect me. And the same thing goes with him. I try to show him as much respect as possible, just because he gives me that respect. I don't have to deal with too much of the talking back, too much of the attitude. Now, granted, teenagers will be teenagers, so, you know, you get those times. However, a situation where they're getting out of hand, then yeah. But if you start early with the lines of communication, with listening and the respect, 9 times out of 10, you probably won't have to lay hands on your kid. Granted, you know, teenage years is a little bit frustrating.
And with some black mothers raising their just children in general, some of them would like yell at their child for like the smallest thing, like breaking a glass or something. Someone would yell at them for that. And then that would install fear in them. They wouldn't want to come to you about anything small. Or yep. That could lead to the lying about small stuff and them not really trusting your reaction because they'd be scared.
That's a good point. I hope you guys heard that. Yeah, that's a really good point. I see a lot of mothers that talk to their kids any kind of way. They cussing at them and everything else and constantly always yelling. Well, you forget that a child feels disrespected just like you. They may not know how to express that, but they can feel like they've been disrespected. And in turn, that causes them to be disrespectful to you. Whether it be them not listening, whether they're older, and that causes them to be disrespectful to you. And I've seen a lot of videos of, you know, I think I posted a video on a page a while back, sometime last year, about a child like really being disrespectful to their mom. But I started to notice how this mom was addressing her daughter, calling her out of her name and, you know, cussing at her. That is not a way to deal with it. And I know as moms, we get frustrated. Believe me, I know. However, we have to be patient, because whatever you show them, this is what they're taking with them. So if you immediately come out the gate with disrespect, then how do you expect them to respect you? I've already went over communication. Please let me know if I'm missing anything or if you guys have any opinions. And that's just how do we correct with our boys. Moving on to how do we correct this in our men. Before you are quick to say something negative about, and I'm going to say this, by my black men, you need to think of the positive first. And what I mean is, I'm probably the most optimistic person ever. The glass is always half full. Regardless of how negative a man is, there's always something positive. And that's why I say I'm definitely rooting for you all. Because I want y'all to win. And I don't want to get emotional. Like I said, I'll end up crying on this live and it's embarrassing. But I'm rooting for y'all and I want you to win. And I think that all of our men have some sort of potential. Even the ones that y'all say ain't shit has some type of potential. Communication. If you're in a relationship with someone or you're dating someone, communicate. You don't know what that man has to deal with when he walks out that door. Keep in mind that our men are naturally strong. They are naturally soldiers, okay? So they may come home and say nothing is wrong. Everything is good. But when they walk out that door, it's a different thing. I'm not for sure exactly what all you have to deal with on a regular day basis, because I'm not a man, but I'm sure it's pretty tough from dealing with, you know, if your money ain't up, you know what I mean? If you're not in the financial state that you want to be in to provide for your family, the humiliation that you may have to deal with at work, the police alone is a whole nother situation. So it's a lot that they already have to deal with. So I'm asking my women, take time to understand that. Take time to communicate to that. And don't do that just one time. Don't just say, okay, is everything okay? And if he say, oh, no, it's good, or whatever the case may be, you keep the momentum going. Because one day, hopefully, he'll be able to open up and say, yeah, this is what's going on. That way you have a better understanding and know how to deal with it. And again, that goes back to knowing their history. It's important to know whoever you're dealing with or that man's history, what they done been through, how they was raised, a number of different things. Be their support system. Because if nobody else is rooting for them, we have to. We have to. So signing off, like I said, I'm rooting for you, my black man. I love y'all. If ain't nobody else supporting you, I will, regardless of whatever. I'm currently working on this program, especially for the men that are in prison. So stay tuned to that. Hopefully we'll be able to get that launched and get that up and moving by the end of this year. Not your typical reentry program. It's going to be a little bit more detailed, a little bit more support, because a lot of the programs that are made for our men that are in prison are made by people who don't even care about them. So I figure, why not? Since I love y'all. I'm going to leave this with some facts for you guys. And what I failed to mention this in the beginning when I first started, but I was looking at the number of homicides that are happening in Columbus right now. And so far as of, I think it was February 18th, and this is on the media release on CPD's website, there have been a total of 30 homicides. Okay. Out of those 30 homicides, 26 of them are black males. It's just sickening. 26 of them are black males that are between the ages of 14 and 35. So they're getting them young. It's too many senseless killings going on, and it's become the norm at this point. Because I know that I turn on the news, I watch the news every morning before I go to work, and you hear about somebody getting killed or somebody getting shot, and then it's like, oh, another one, and you keep on moving. But I wanted to bring this to you guys' attention because you look at it a little bit differently when you're dealing with numbers. So again, it's been 30 homicides as of February 18th of this year. 26 of them were black males. Only 3 of those 30 were white. Now, this is where it gets kind of, I don't know, raise an eyebrow for me. When I looked at these reports, and I was up really late last night, so about 4 in the morning. I don't sleep anyway, hardly. But I looked at these reports, and the majority of the homicides that were dealing with black men, they don't have any suspects. No arrest at all. Which I thought that was kind of weird, because either these guys that are killing our men are assassins and they just can't be found, or is something else going on with that. I don't know how much I trust that y'all don't have any suspects, which makes me believe, and I'm kind of going off a topic here for a whole nother segment, that maybe they are organizing this. You know, maybe they're picking us off. But like I said, the information is on their website. It's not like I cannot make this up. It's on their website. I will post a link onto the group page so you guys can see what I'm seeing. And a lot of these men that were, you know, killed were, some of these happened within the same day, which I think is just, it's just crazy. And the fact that the majority of those cases don't have any suspects is crazy to me as well. I will say this, the youngest so far this year was 2 14-year-old boys that was killed this year. And I think this hit home for me because I have a 14-year-old son. And I don't want to mention, you know, their names or anything like that out of respect for the family and whatever type of investigations that's going on right now. But a mom lost her baby. That does a lot. One of these boys went to school with my son, which that was really close to home for me. And it was a simple situation where he just was out walking. And that happened. And it was very unfortunate. Again, between the ages of 14 and 35, and if I break it down even more to that, a lot of them were about 18 to 25 that are, you know, being killed. I don't know what the situation is around it. I don't know if they were just in the streets or just out random. I don't know what the situation is. But again, that's somebody's baby. That's somebody's son. That is somebody's brother, possibly even somebody's father, that is now gone. And the flip side of that is not only are the person who has been killed, their moms then lost their babies, but another baby has been lost to the system. Now that's just some food for thought. Two moms have lost their babies. Two brothers, two sisters, two fathers have lost their sons. Two, you know, sets of children may have lost their fathers. One to death and the other one to prison. Right now, the prison population in Ohio for black males is at 19,584. And it may not seem like a lot just because of the population that's throughout, you know, Ohio is in the millions or whatever it is, but it is 19,584 of our men that are in prison right now. That is, it's a sad situation. And this number is as of July of 2020, I think it was. So just imagine what's been happening since then. We're talking, what is that, over 6 months? So, you know, that number is increasing. Anyways, I just wanted to give you guys those factual numbers. Again, I will post the link underneath this video. He said, that is why we teach our babies how to protect themselves in the physical way, mental way, and spiritual way. Yes, I definitely agree with you. Not trying to jump back here, but I definitely agree with you. I think self-defense is important. And I got some, you know, some negative feedback from outsiders that has something to say about, you know, me teaching my son or his father teaching him how to use or handle a gun. I don't see anything wrong with it because I have raised my son to be responsible and to know that it is not a toy. And I think that is something that he needs to learn how to do. And that's not just going to be the basis of what he's learning, but it is good for him to have an understanding of it, not to know that it's, you know, a toy. Another thing too is, jumping back real quick, building up our boys' mental state. It's a lot of suicides out there from lack of communication and us not talking to, you know, our babies. Build up their mental state. They need to have strong minds because when they go out into this world, it's going to be hard for them. And make it your business to keep them in tune on what is going on out here. Try not to coddle them too much. You know what I mean? Because they need to be prepared. They need to be prepared mentally. They need to be prepared physically, spiritually, emotionally, and financially. I'm a big advocate when it comes to entrepreneurship. I'm all for making a way for yourself. I teach my son those skills because he needs to know that in the event, if you cannot punch a clock, if you can't get you a 9-to-5, or in the event, if you never ever go, you know, to college or finish school, you need to be able to make some money that is legitimate. Okay? Because I refuse to allow my son or the streets to drape him off. Like, I just refuse to do that. Like, there's other ways to make money outside of selling drugs or doing stuff illegally, outside of robbing. Let's focus on our kids. Spend time with them more, listen to them, communicate, you know, teach them those strong values that they're going to need when they step out here into this world and become men. Teach them how to deal with their emotions. Let them know, and some of you, you know, fathers and men out there may disagree with me, but it's okay to have an emotion. It's okay for them to cry. If you're sad about something, okay. Let it out. Don't hold that in. That way they know how to deal with situations when it comes to them, instead of the first thing they want to do is go pick up a gun. Because there's a lot of these boys that don't know how to deal with their emotions.
It's not even really about dealing with your emotions. It's, mm-hmm. It's basically mainly probably, yeah, that is going to it. It's mainly because they either don't know how to fight, so they think the first thing they need to do is go get a gun and go shoot if they do lose the fight.
That's what I'm saying. And that's the point that I'm trying to make. Like, a lot of it has to do with them not being able to deal with their emotions. And again, a lot of them are scared to fight. So they go and pick up a gun. help them be able to deal with those, how to deal with confrontation. That is a big thing, because anytime you get into a confrontation or altercation, you don't necessarily have to go and pick up a gun. And to me, that is a lack of having a strong mind, which is why, this is going to sound crazy, in some cases, bullying is helpful, especially if they need to learn how to deal with those type of emotions, if that makes sense. But yeah, definitely listen to them. That's all I can say is listen, not only to, our boys. But yeah, somebody said build confidence. Yes, build confidence in your kids. Not arrogance, but confidence. You know what I mean? Make sure they remain humble. Confidence is key. Respect is key. How they respect them, how they view themselves is an important factor in their identity. So
that's why you go into self-worth.
Yeah, you go into self-worth. Love and raise our boys. Not just love them, but raise them. Teach them necessary skills that they're going to need to go out into this world, especially when it comes to, conducting business. How to address people. And that starts with just simple manners, simple communication, and all of that. So definitely instill those skills into our boys. And as far as our men, again, instead of, I'll keep saying this, you hear me say this a lot, I love all of you. And again, I'll be damned if I let anybody bash you, because if you don't have a voice for you, I'll be your voice regardless. Next Sunday's food for thought, we're going to be talking about our women and our girls. Please hit my inbox, leave a comment on anything that you guys want me to go over. I'm all for doing the research on. I'm probably going to be posting some form of video from a few different known Black psychologists to the page. That's pertaining more so to our women and our girls, same way I did with the boys and the men. So hopefully that I cover everything. Like I said, you guys, hit my inbox. Let me know. Of course, I'm about to promote myself. Shout out to Being Her. We got beer butters. We got sugar scrubs. What is it? Body butter. Definitely shout out to that. We still got that rolling. Website is coming soon. Another big ups to my son's small business that he's just starting, Ox Sauce. If y'all have not gotten y'all a bottle yet, shame on you. Shame on you for not getting a bottle, because it's good. Definitely hit my inbox if you want to place those orders. His website is coming soon. We're trying to get the legalities out the way, so, don't nobody else take my baby stuff. But it's good sauce, right?
We're
coming out with a new sauce. You hear that, people? A new sauce is coming to you soon. It's supposed to be fire. Literally. So, I love you guys. Y'all be safe. Happy Sunday. Thank you for joining in on this Food for Thought. Going over our saving our boys and empowering our men. I love you guys. Until next time, I will see you guys next week, same time. Again, hit my inbox. Peace.
Got King Mayor the cities in reverse fiends the willies. It sound foul, but every girl I meet to go downtown. I'd open every cell in Attica, send them to Africa.
If I rule the world,
imagine that.